Very much.
Started.
So welcome to the art and science of website revamping. First, a word from our sponsor. This webinar is organized by GFAR, the Global Forum on Agriculture Research. During this webinar, the man behind the scene is Charles Plummer, who will manage the slides and the technical aspect of the webinar. So he's going to be the policeman muting everybody. My name is Peter Cassie, and I will be moderating the questions. Charles and I both work for the GFAR Secretariat and manage their social media and online media channels and projects. But the main person behind this webinar is Antonella Pastore. Antonella is an information architect and a project manager who worked for many years on information systems design and systems development for large international organizations. She has been involved in numerous website revamps, including the latest CGIAR.org and GFAR.net revamps. Now, towards the end of the webinar, we'll be joined also by Mia Sainz from the CGIAR Research Program on Water, Land, and Ecosystems. Mia will share some of her experiences of their recent elaborate revamp process. On the logistics for this webinar, we're all connected through a service called BlueJeans, which allows everyone to see the presentation and the speakers. Feedback, tips, and questions should only be done via the chat box. So please mute your video and audio. Otherwise, it will suck up a lot of bandwidth and the background noise will disturb the rest of the flow of the webinar. Even though we are with a big group, I would still like this webinar to be as interactive as possible. So I do encourage you to send me remarks and suggestions and questions during the presentation using the chat box. The icon of the chat box you see on the top right-hand side corner of your window. During the webinar also, we will stop at regular intervals to check your chat input. And then through the questions and suggestions, we'll rehash it and present it over to Antonella for her feedback. So if anything pops up during the presentation, just type it in into the chat box. After this webinar, we will send you a mail with a link to the recording of the webinar, some of the links to websites or resources mentioned during this webinar, or questions, answers to questions that we couldn't answer during the webinar itself. And now let's tackle a topic which is one of my favorites. An area where I see many organizations struggle, the website redesign process or website revamps, typically complex processes involving both content and technical issues, which are all too often consuming way too much time, way too much effort, and way too much money than anticipated. Antonella, the floor is yours for the art and science of website revamps.
Okay, thank you, Peter, and welcome everybody. I see a lot of people online, and I confess I am so excited and nervous. So I just hope this is going to be fine and that you will find it interesting. Charles is going to start the slideshow. Can you move on to the next? So the first slide, Charles, please. Okay. So my name is Antonella Pastore. I'm an information architect and user research specialist. I have survived quite a few digital projects since I started working in the digital arena. And in the meanwhile, I've also managed to become a certified project manager. But deep in my heart, I remain an information architect with lots of experience in website development. So today I'll stick to my good old title that I'm very fond of. I started working on the internet in 1999, and I have designed websites in different roles with and without content management systems in projects that could take just a few days or a few months. As Peter mentioned, I was in the CGIAR from 2007 to 2012. And over the last 4 years, I've been working as a freelancer on a variety of projects, from knowledge management to website revamps. So I've worn different hats along my career, but for sure what I can say is what I've learned about technology, I learned it from getting my hands dirty with it. And the reason why I'm talking with you today is that having been a survivor of website revamps, I'm here to tell the story, and I can assure you I'm not the only one. You know, website revamps don't kill, they just make you stronger. So rest assured that there's light at the end of the tunnel. On the next slide, please. Okay, what are we gonna have? What are you gonna have on your screens today? The session will be roughly managed in four parts. I'll introduce what I think is special about revamps based on my experience, and I will review the factors that may be overlooked when we embark on a website revamp project. Then we will look at a high-level overview of the key steps involved in a website revamp process. And these steps can be scaled up or down depending on your specific context. And in the meanwhile, I'll do my best to illustrate the process with tools, tips, and real-life examples. And we will have Mia contributing, you know, a real-life story from the WLE website revamp. And finally, we will review the evolution in the approach to website revamps over the last few years. Next, please. And okay, so let's get straight into the heart of the matter. What is special about revamps? What do we have to do differently or the same as in any website development project? This session in particular is not about project management per se, or about the perfect framework to pull off a successful project, because revamps can be simple or complex, and you may be involved in your specific role, or like me in the past, will have to wear different hats. But it will be important for you in any of these roles to know what needs to be done and how events may unfold. So let's start to have a common scenario we all can relate to. So the reason why you should care about website revamps is that they go in cycles. Sooner or later, you're likely to go through a website revamp in your professional life. So let's have a look at this diagram that sort of, you know, illustrates the typical cycle of a website revamp. At the very beginning, a website is designed and launched, then it is implemented, and then for some reason or another, it gets neglected. Or more realistically, as we will see, a lot of things can happen in the meanwhile. And in terms of the external and internal driving forces that lead a team to revamp a website. And after a few years, you or someone else in your team cries out in front of the website, "Oh my God, this website really needs an overhaul." So at this point, you mobilize a few senior managers, put together the funds, define the project, and off you go. Sometimes hiring a company that will help you do another big bang launch. You go through the revamp, launch the new website, and the cycle starts again. And after a few years, here we go again. Oh my God, we need another overhaul. So I guess this may sound familiar for some of us. Next, please. As I was saying, revamps go in cycles, and these cycles can take a few years or shorter time frames, depending on how a website is managed or the specific or institutional context you work in. In a traditional website revamp, a website is launched, and after a few years, it is no longer aligned with whatever change is happening in the organization or in the program or in the context you operate in. But there is an alternative approach to that, which is evolutionary. In this approach, the website is managed and revamped in smaller, shorter cycles that help it keep it aligned with internal and external changes. Now, I would like to, you know, close the presentation and tell you right away which is good and which is bad. But unfortunately, there is no answer to that, because it all depends on how your website is managed and in which context you're operating. You may have noticed that strong brands such as Amazon they rarely redesign their website because they're not fundamentally changing their brand strategy or their corporate strategy, their sales process, etc. They are constantly realigning their website to the evolution in their markets. However, if your website is not working and it's time for a big change, then a complete website revamp may be the way to chart that new direction. Next, please. So to simplify, and only for the sake of simplification, we can have two types of website revamps: a complete website revamp and an evolutionary website revamp. A complete website revamp is holistic reconsideration of strategy, technology, process, content, and marketing, while an evolutionary website revamp is driven by user data and feedback and allows organizations to reformulate, prioritize, and apply website updates on shorter timeframes. Now, I'm loosely quoting this from an article that I found on Lean Labs, and I wish I would have been so articulate to write it myself. But the point is, okay, let's simplify. Let's look at these two approaches to website revamp. And whether you decide to go for either one or the other, or a mix of them, depends on what is driving the need to revamp your website. So what is important to analyze as the first step? It's what is the drive behind the revamp? What are the key questions that need to be addressed before we put our hands on an existing site or an existing information system? We have to start from some key considerations that will eventually impact the way we structure the process, the resources we allocate, the amount of time that we will invest in the different steps, and that will orient the overall nature of the project. Next, please. So, where do we start from? There are different, you know, areas in which we have to go and find out about what is going on. Let's start from the user side. What's up on that side? Has the site been tested with users? Has feedback been collected and analyzed? What are the changes that seem to emerge from this research and analysis? Is anything particular emerging from traffic analysis? I'm talking about the website traffic. Are the contents on the website going to be better promoted? Do we need to improve their usage? Do we need to improve their visibility? Are there any patterns that we can observe across all these different sources of information about what people search, access, or not? Now, in the type of business we're in, usually in research and development, we know, for example, that discovering and using information is considered very important. So one of the frequent communications issues that we have to address is related to people asking for up-to-date information. And this is a tricky one if you look at it from the point of view of what can I do about it, okay? Because it may be related, for example, to search engine optimization, just, you know, information on the website not being retrieved via search engines. Or it may be related to the technical savviness of your target groups, of the people you try to reach out to. For example, we may find out that our target users rely heavily on email instead of social media or news apps to keep track of news. Next, please. Another area worth investigating to find the drive and identify the drive for a revamp, it's the institutional side. Is a new process looming at the horizon? Is a new organizational structure being implemented? Is the institution drafting a new strategy that requires an updated positioning? Is the brand involved? You know, we know that, you know, in some cases, in cycles, some organizations may go through a radical reorganization that may even call for a new brand to be designed and developed. Next, please. And last but not least, we have to investigate what's up on the technical side. Just based on our experience, on an anecdotal evidence, we know that changing technology is often mentioned as the main reason for a website revamp. Like, for example, oh, we have to change our content management system. Sometimes, you know, changing the CMS is a decision that is driven by a change in the publishing process or just the workforce at your disposal. You have more or less people depending on what you need to achieve. But there may be broader changes outside of your organization that can drive a revamp on the technical side. For example, just consider the increase in mobile device users that we've witnessed over the last few years and de facto has forced so many organizations to move to a mobile responsive website. So in conclusion, you know, we can just broadly classify the drives for a website revamp project as changing in the institutional identity and strategy, including the communication strategy, a change in one or more processes and the distribution of functions inside the organization, the change in technology, and in some cases, you can have change in all of this, in all of these areas. And each one of these factors, whether it's the predominant one or it's just one piece of the puzzle, will shape the revamp project in different ways and on different timescales. And I would like to ask if there are any questions or comments at this point before we move on.
Thanks, Anto. We had one question coming in from Boogie, where he pointed out where you said website revamp every 3 years. So the elaborate question would be, did you see this period every 3 years or 5 years? Did you see this shortening over time, where maybe a decennia ago, this might be much longer, or we're now driven by technology, fast releases of CMS updates, organizations maybe becoming more competitive, trying to be more on the edge. If you've seen this spirit of revamping shortening over time?
Well, one clarification first. The diagram in particular talks about 3 years, and that's just for the purpose of giving an example, because there's another one that I'm using that says 5 years. So don't take the data on the screen as the as having some statistical value. Based on my experience, I've seen websites being revamped on any timescale. It could be every 3 years, it could be every 10 years. So I was recently, you know, a few months ago, I was recently involved in the technical assessment of a very formal procurement process of an international organization that had released a request for proposal for a company to hire an external company for an extensive website revamp. And we were talking of a website that had been fundamentally been set up 10 years before. And then, you know, over that period, they had, you know, sort of, you know, enhanced or added pieces to the technology landscape and to the information landscape. And the result was a big concoction of stuff that didn't talk to each other. So yes, you can have 3 year cycles, you can have 5 year cycles, you can have 10 year cycles. But what is important is also the state in which you will find the website at the moment that the change kicks in. Does this sort of, you know, answer the question?
Sure. And did you see this over time? Did you see this shortening where maybe in the past years that period of the need of the revamp became shorter?
Not yet. And okay. But that's part of the evolution.
Yeah, indeed. Okay.
And we will get back to, you know, the complexities of shortening the time frame, to shortening the cycles later on in the presentation.
Very good. Also later in the presentation would be an answer to another question from Boogie on how to obtain feedback effectively from visitors and readers, surveys or questionnaires, but you'll tackle this later on in the presentation.
In the research section, exactly. And then, you know, I'll try, let's see what, you know, this section of the presentation answers, provides as background information, and then if there is any additional question or information that I can provide, I'll be happy to provide it.
Okay, very good, Antonella. Please carry on.
Okay. Can you move to the next slide, Charles, please? Okay, so let's get into the second part of the presentation. Let's have a look at this high-level process overview of a website revamp. So let's clarify, you know, whatever the scale and the approach, whether it's a complete revamp or an evolutionary one, in practice, we can think of a revamp process as going through four key steps: research, architect, design, and implement. Now, each step involves some distinctive activities that could take more or less time or more or less resources, depending on the factors that drive the revamp, and that can be also iterated. So let's have a look at these activities. Next, please, Charles. Okay, research. One distinctive trait of revamps is that we don't start in a vacuum. We have a lot of information that is already available. So at the very beginning, we do a lot of research to define the revamp projects. Of course, you can structure this research process in many ways, but you know, based on my experience, these are four distinctive activities in a website revamp, in particular the research phase: the content assessment, branding and or rebranding, if that's one of the driving factors, the technology audit, and user research. Then, with this solid background, we move on to the architect phase. Tap, please. Thank you. So in the next big step, we move on to architecting the website. In this step, you know, the distinctive activities that I would flag as very important and often overlooked are content inventory and audit, which is the natural consequence of a content assessment and an important preparatory step for migration, which is another one of those distinctive activity of revamp and sometimes very, very complex and overlooked. Information architecture, user experience design, and system integration are not particularly distinctive or revamp per se, because you have to go through that part of the architectural setup in any website development project. However, in a revamp, it's worth looking at these activities together and go through them in an iterative way, particularly when the project implies the integration of different platforms. For example, the content management system that needs to talk and exchange data with a document repository and with the social media platforms, etc. So going back and forth with, you know, successive refinements through information architecture, user experience, and system integration may be very important in a website revamp. And then we move on to the design step, that here we intended as visual design per se, and as such it's part of any project. And the reason I am highlighting the design review as a distinctive activity is that a design review or a cycle of design reviews should be organized on the basis of the objectives and the rationale that have been defined during the research phase. Plus, you know that there are going to be lots of expectations. There are usually lots of expectations when it comes to website development. And in particular, you know, aesthetic and arbitrary considerations may get in the way, while what you really want to get out of a design review is to obtain feedback that is actionable and also manage your stakeholders' expectations, that's for sure. Last but not least, we have the implementation step. Here I'm highlighting migration and redirection as distinctive activities of Revamps. Now, the complexity of migration and redirection is often overlooked in my experience, but they are very important because, for example, we want to guarantee that, you know, the website search engine rank is not compromised by lots of broken links and that your users maintain access to existing valuable content. And now let's drill down into some of these activities and see some examples. All right, so first mega step in the process is research. And as I said, we've got plenty of information to start from to assess the existing system and define the new one. Next, please. All right, here we are in the process, okay? Now, depending on the drive of the revamp, all or some of these activities, content assessment, branding or rebranding, technology audit, and user research, can receive more or less attention, more or less resources, but at any rate, it's good to look at all of them together because all of them will contribute to the analysis of the status quo. They will help us define the problems that we want to address with a revamp, and we will use this information to design the solution. Tap, please, Charles. Okay. Our goal at this stage is to produce the core project documentation. Documentation is always overlooked. Everybody wants to rush into to the drawing board, the talking with people, getting the designers to get some mock-ups. Please, I mean, documentation is so important. It's the opportunity that you give you and your team and your key stakeholders to reflect and distill what you want to get out of this. And what we want to get is a rationale, a number of briefs for, you know, the visual, for, you know, the visual design, for the content, for the technical side, the system requirements, the user requirements, such as process, workflow, the type of engagement you want to have with your users. And you can have as many tools as you need. Can you please show the next box, Charles, please? Right. There are many tools and methods to go through the research through the research steps and the distinctive activities. These are just some of the ones that I have used in the projects I've been involved in, and that I will give you some examples in a moment. Next. All right. So. The rationale. So we've seen that among the driving factors of a revamp, there can be changes in the institutional setup, in the technology, and in the process. Okay? So this was the case with the CGIAR.org revamp, the big one, the one in 2011-2012. That, as I said, it started in summer 2011 and was completed a year later. In this case, we had a lot of information available to formulate the problems that we needed to address, and starting from those, you know, distill the design objectives. and we had, you know, a problem in the institutional side, in the technology side, and also in the process side. One of the issues that we wanted to address and was the out-of-date technology, okay? That was calling for a major replacement of all the technical components of the website. But we were aware that of the fact that we wanted to preserve the value of the domain. Next, please, Charles. So with Webmaster's tools and traffic analysis, we assessed what we called at the time the value of the domain. You know, the CGIAR.org domain had been online since 1998. It was a very, very rich website, and there was basically, you know, a hosting the whole institutional memory of the of CGIAR. So we didn't want to run the risk that moving things around and removing outdated content would diminish the value of the domain in search engines, break the links, and lose information. So we needed to have a good case for investing a lot of time and effort in planning for migration. So the data, I'm not going to read the data you see on the screen. This is just an example of the metrics that we collected and looked at. And we compiled it using a combination of link popularity, traffic, and search analytics. And as I said, these were the metrics that help us, you know, make the case for taking care of migration in a very, very peculiar way. Next, please. Content assessment. So content assessment is when you just take stock of the content that you have and how it is performing and whether you need to just stick to migration or whatever is there, or you have to, you know, rewriting and updating and have a completely new approach to developing and publishing your content. At the time, this is another example from the CGIAR.org revamp. To assess the content, we did an inventory and audit, and more on this later, but we mainly looked at how we could reorganize the content to reflect the new status of the organization and also to take a fresh look at the thematic approach to organizing online content. And to do this, we ran a card sorting exercise with the advisory group members, which was composed of the heads of communications at the time, because we wanted to collect data on meaningful groupings of content and categories, taking into account the content that was already available, because we wanted to carry it over, and the objectives to represent the new CGIAR that at the time was a consortium. To do this, we used a tool called Optimal Sort, that is an online card sorting software provided by optimalworkshop.com. The free account allows you to run 10 questionnaires, and for more you have to pay, but it's really a very small, affordable account. As for the analysis, we will have a look now at an example of the results that you get out of card sorting. With small numbers of participants, I would say up to 15 or 20, you don't have a lot of statistical solidity. So really don't worry about statistical robustness of your result if you want to do it with a small number of people, like from 10 to 20, okay? But it's still very useful to see what we're going to see on the next slide, which is called the similarity matrix. So you have different ways of analyzing the results that come out from a card sorting exercise. One way of doing it is to look at the similarity matrix, which is the, you know, this very colorful diagram that you have on the screen now. The similarity metrics shows how many participants in the study agree with each pair combination of cards. And the numbers describe how many times the two adjacent cards were placed in the same category. Now, too complicated to understand just based on what you see on your screen. So regardless of the actual numbers, the clusters in darker blue that you see at the top show that the scientific topics belong together, and those appearing at the top also show the overall priority that could be given to the specific topics. So this type of results gives you a clear idea of where to put priority in developing your content and grouping your content. Next, please. Okay. Card sorting is a very simple concept to grasp, but can be pretty tough to analyze. So my recommendation is that you study, if you haven't done it before, you want to give it a try, you give a look and actually study this article, The Card Sorting, A Definitive Guide, and try to bring whatever you know it can do for you in your own context. What I can tell you is that usually it is very well received by the participants that you will invite into a card sorting exercise. You just have to make sure you reassure them that you're not testing their knowledge of their website or their organization, but you're interested in hearing them talk through their mental associations. In fact, I have to say I prefer doing face-to-face card sorting because I can combine it with think aloud. In a face-to-face card sorting, what the participants have to sort the cards into groups and at the same time explain what reasoning they're following while they group the cards. This will give you a lot of insights into the kind of associations that you may draw between or among your topics, or your content, or your categories. The other interesting thing is that card sorting can be used in many creative ways. The last time I did it, the participants were asked to group the cards by user tasks. That is, by the task that we had identified during the previous discovery phase in the project. And this led to very interesting conversations on how the content could be revised to address the site users' information needs. So, and so much so that the results from this card sorting informed two big areas of this specific website revamp project. The content strategy, I mean, what are we gonna say, how we're gonna write it, and in what kind of tone and language, and the information architecture, and the navigation eventually. Next, please. All right. So the example that I gave you for card sorting were very, very, very much linked to the task of assessing the content, how to rewrite it, how to reorganize it, and how we had informed the information architecture and content strategy. But you know, card sorting is also part of is one of the tools and tools and methods that we use to run user research. User research, in fact, can inform different aspects of a revamp. And as I mentioned, information architecture, content strategy, and last but not least, interface design, interaction, and even the formulation and the delivery of digital services. Okay. It just can take the shape of workshops, on one-on-one interviews, online questionnaires, and if you have the opportunity to meet with a sample of participants, you may combine it with the observation of your participants carrying out specific tasks on the website. Here on this table, I've just listed the key components that you have to keep in mind when you plan this this type of activity. First, you have to do sampling and profiling, which, can you go back, please? Thank you, Charles. you have to do the sampling and profiling. You have to identify the stakeholders or the representative sample of your users, and you need to profile them at least by function, by the focus in using their site, whether or not they're a contributor, whether or not they're in HQ or in the field, or you know, in the typical working environment they operate in. Planning is a very important step in doing user research. Here you just have to be very scientific about it. You just have to treat user research like any research project. You define the research goals, and from those you derive the questions that you want the fact and the data that you collect to answer. Then you plan the methodology. In this case, I'm focusing here on the interviews, which is a bit of tough nut to crack. Okay, so you have to prepare the questions, and then you can run the interviews one-on-one, face-to-face, or online. Personally, I prefer to run one-on-one interviews instead of in workshops, just because you're going to need way more experience in facilitating that kind of activity. And whether you, if you have the opportunity, you can combine it with the observations have fruitful and meaningful observations of your website users. You need to identify the critical issues based on the available research. You need to identify the critical parts on the website that you want feedback on those critical parts. You design the tasks and the focus of your observation, and you prepare the script and the drilling question. Next slide. And we'll see a very basic example of a field, what I call a field guide. That is, this is the Bible, where I put down everything that I have formulated during the planning phase, where I put down the tasks, where I put down the script of the interviews and the exact task that I'm going to ask participants to do. So whatever method you choose or is feasible, we are talking here about qualitative research, okay? So and planning is very important if you want to get some useful and actionable information. So in first thing, the profile. Then next, you have to define and get the approval of the research goal. This is very important to be socialized and agreed upon by the people who will make the strategic decisions on the website and give you the money to actually implement those. And last but not least, remember that qualitative research generates a lot of information. Whether it's the interviews or the observations, you're gonna be flooded by notes of what you have observed and what people have told you. And the analysis is the most consuming part of the activity. So it's important to identify right from the start the focus that you're going to apply during the observation and later during analysis. Next. So, as I said, user research can inform different aspects of a revamp, and a way to bring it all together, in particular when you're running it in a very thorough, deep way, is to channel the findings from your research to inform different aspects of a website. So you will have to need it space. So this picture is from a mission in Nigeria that I did a couple of years ago. And it was so rich. After 2 weeks of interviewing and analyzing the website and talking with the communication people and talking with the technology people, basically there was so much that was being collected that the only way to look at it and review it was to use a whole office wall to stick up the findings. So the wall was a way to bring together all that had emerged from these 2 weeks of research. And the purpose was to have a physical visual support for the workshop that I ran with the web and communication team so that we could review and validate and expand on the findings and finally achieve the definition of the goals, information architecture, content management requirements, and visual design requirements. Okay, this concludes the area on research, and I would like to ask if there are any questions and comments before we move on into the into inventory and audit. Over to you, Peter.
Thanks, Anto. Well, you mentioned that personally you prefer one-on-one interviews with the users, representative for the different user groups or stakeholder groups. Peter Burry said many organizations seem to be afraid of too blunt online feedback. I assume that in your research part, when you do the user surveys, you would keep the answers to yourselves. You would, or would you do a public survey where everybody can see the feedback of everybody else?
Oh, no. No, absolutely not. So first of all, qualitative research, when you do the interviews possibly combined with the observations, you have to identify, profile, and choose and recruit exactly the right people that can be your key informants. Okay? So guaranteeing confidentiality to the person that you invite to contribute their time and attention is critical. Okay, so eventually at the stage of analysis, you only report on anonymized and or aggregated feedback after it has been analyzed. You never share the raw data with your senior managers. Okay, I'm wearing the researcher's hat. Surveys, particularly online, they are a completely different tool, okay? They may be quantitative and qualitative, but you actually want them to be more on the quantitative side. I mean, you want people to rate on a quantitative scale any aspect that is of interest to you. Knowing that surveys, online in particular, are based on self-reporting. I mean, people can tell you whatever they want, okay? So there, you need to have a bit of statistical solidity. So if you're going for online surveys, you have to promote it and spread the word as much as possible, because there you really need some statistical solidity to sort of compensate the fact that people can tell you whatever they want. And usually people that participate and spend the time in on an online surveys are very motivated. So they really have something to say. Okay, so you need to keep that in mind. Again, whatever data you collect, if you're a researcher, online questionnaires will most likely be anonymous. And that feedback or whatever you get in there need to be analyzed. Now, with quantitative measures, it's sort of easier, to share the figures right away with senior management, for example. But with qualitative feedback, you do have to analyze it and put it in relation with any other aspects of the project or the website that you're aware of. If the question is how you treat the confidentiality of the data, but I sort of sensed that sometimes it may be hard to convince your managers to devote some time to do user research. Yes, it can be tough, in particular if you are trying to sell it as a highly structured and formal process. But then it's really up to, how good you are at convincing your manager and giving the time or giving the money to hire a company to do this. But I can assure you that I've seen a couple of senior managers' faces light up when I show them the results, because, their aha moment was, Oh my God, this is the best PR tool that we've ever used. It's incredible how much you know, the participants, the people that participate in these sessions can appreciate the opportunity they've had to be articulate about what they think, to be contributing to a common project. Most of the time, they will have very interesting and useful suggestions, and in particular, they will feel acknowledged, and that. In a running user, doing user research is a fantastic public relations tool. It's a fantastic stakeholder and management method. So yes, it may be tough to recruit people at the time that you need them. Well, when you actually do it, trust me, they're going to be on your side.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks, Anto. Amy says, well, this part of a revamp process, the research part, seems to be quite a complex process to cover in depth. I've seen you included a couple of links on the specific tools. Would you have any literature that you can suggest that maybe we can circulate after the webinar on the research project itself or on user surveys?
Absolutely, yes. There are a couple of super classics that I will be very happy to share.
Very good. Thanks, Anto. We're ready for the next one.
Okay, so let's move on and get straight into what information architects and content managers relish on or just hate with all their hearts, which is inventory and audit of content. During inventory, this is a very specific activity in a revamp project that we do at the start of the architectural phase, and our goal is to generate a list of content assets and audit it for update or archival, and if migration is involved, we lay the foundation for the migration of the content to the new system. Next. Okay, here we are. Can you tap twice, Charles? We can show the boxes right away. Okay. So here in inventory and audit, our goal at this stage is to produce the content migration and development plan. We need to have an annotated inventory of the URLs. To each one of them, we are going to assign an audit value, i.e. what's going to happen to each and every one of those URLs and the destinations in the new site. The assumption at this stage is that you have at least a high-level information architecture of the new website defined at least as the main content areas, the content types, and the metadata. It's important. I don't know how familiar you are with the typical information architecture jargon. Here we are at risk because I am one. But you know, you may have heard that, you know, when we do information architecture, one of the things that we define is the content hierarchy of the website: first level, second level, third level, and so on. And we design the navigation based on the content structure and also on where we want people to go. Now, at this stage, it's not really relevant that we have finalized the hierarchy and the navigation design, because there may be another activity going on, which is the work on the systems integration, i.e. when we join together, you know, a CMS with a document repository, for example. So even if you see here on the diagram that inventory, audit, information architecture, user experience, and integration are on a linear sequence, in reality, they can go one into the other in very short iterations, okay, until we have all of them defined. So again, These are activities that you have at the architectural phase of each and every, you know, digital project. But for revamps in particular, and in particular, if you have a big chunk of work going into systems integration, you may want to run the inventory audit, information architecture integration, in an iterated way. Some of the tools that I have used, but you know, trust me, these are not the only ones. These are just the ones that I've put my hands on, are XenuLink Sleuth, of which I'm a very faithful user since 1999, and File Systems Inventories, and your best friend, Excel. Definitely, spreadsheets. And in particular for the inventory and revamp, I'd like to share an example from the CGIAR.org revamp. Next, please, Charles. Okay, inventory and audit. We collect all the URLs, we decide what to do with the content on each and every one of those URLs, okay? And we set the destinations in the new website. This is the simple version. As I mentioned at the very beginning, talking about the CGIAR.org revamp, one of the principles that we had, we wanted to preserve the value of the domain, so we invested a lot of time in auditing and migrating the content, because we had some very clear principles for that. No broken links and preservation of the value of the domain and the institutional memory. So we started where we combined the list of all the URLs on the old website that we generated with XenuLink Sleuth, and we completed it with a full file system inventory. Then we looked at all these URLs and we started seeing, and we saw that there were some emerging information types. Like, for example, we had event subsites. Okay, so we could decide that, every time we see this pattern, this is an event subsite, and what we're going to do with those, we are going to take them and put them under a frame that says that this is archived online. In the case of the image directory, we decided that we would migrate it as it was, with absolutely no change, in a file system without moving it into the CMS database. Based on this initial analysis, then, you know, once we identified these big chunks that we decided, okay, all the event subsites, they go under a frame, then for each and every piece of content, like articles or media releases or institutional pages, etc., we assigned to each and one of those an action, you know. We identified those that we wanted to update, reconstruct, archive offline, migrate as is, or just frame. Okay? And of course, at the very beginning, we didn't have the new information architecture of the new CGIAR.org website. So at the very beginning, we just put the names of what we used to call the content areas. Okay, this is going under About Us. But as we started building the new website, and moving or publishing the content, we would replace those destinations with the actual URLs of the new website that then were used as the instructions for the automatic redirections from the old URLs to the new ones. Next, please. And this is just, you know, a snapshot of that huge and very precious Excel spreadsheet that we used for the inventory and audit. This is just the final shape that it took, you know, the big Excel with the URLs, the audit values, and the target destinations. And the audit values, as I said, were then used as instructions for the migration script that was developed to bring the existing content into the new system database. Next, please. I will open the floor again, because I realize that an inventory audit can be a tough nut to crack. Are there any questions, any comments, any clarification?
Thanks, Anto. The two questions related to each other from Boogie and Marina relate back again to the research phase. I think it's probably, it might be one of the phases that many people would skip, and they would immediately go, as you mentioned before, immediately go to more the technology phase and the mock-ups of the different screens, etc.
The visual part.
Yeah. Boogie says, well, it looks rather complex and time-consuming. So doing this research, do you have an idea about, you know, how big the budget would be? Of course, you know, the question might be how costly is a car? But I would relate to this also the question from Marina, where she says, listen, we have a revamp plan sitting on our desk. There is some extended research for the research phase in this. But because we have very limited funding, and we do have some challenges in raising funds for a website revamp from our donors, the risk would be that a lot of these funds would be consumed during the research phase. So probably it has to do with the importance of the research phase, but also in generally in the whole process, how much of my resources should I allocate to this? Because of course, this can be a story without end. You can research for years and years and ask every single user for their opinion or her opinion. So a bit related to the research phase and you know, what would it consume of the total budget that you would have for a revamp process? And somewhere, how do you keep it restricted so that the costs would be somewhere still within bounds, Anto?
Okay, so one way to look at user research is whether you're, again, it's like research. Are you going to collect fresh new data or are you going to use secondary data? Okay. I bet you, in most cases, you already have so much information about your users. It's just a matter of collecting it and analyzing it under a new perspective. Okay. Another way would be to structure the research phase through proxies of your users. They're not your users, like for example, your key stakeholders, but you just select those who are in constant touch with whoever is using the website or interacting with the organization. And what I would try to do is to really formulate the questions for the analysis more in terms of what do they think they actually need to solve and address. Let me give you an example. Doing that mission in Nigeria took me one full week of planning and design and 3 weeks in Ibadan with a lot of the analysis going on because I was full time on site. Then when I came back, it took me another perhaps 10 days to write it all down. It was not only the part on user research, we were informing a lot of the project. And we came up with this, you know, very detailed plan that covered, you know, the users, the institutions, the technology, the migration, and so on and so forth. So we're talking about 4-6 weeks of work to get to the plan. Okay, lots of money, risk. I had to travel, etc. All right.
If I can ask, this 6 weeks, this is the research phase, or this would already be the research phase, the architect phase?
Project and the definition of the project. The research per se was 4 weeks.
Yeah.
With travel in
mind. Ready almost to implement?
Yes, because with that, we used the plan to actually run the RFP process, the procurement process. So it was quite comprehensive.
Yeah. So 6 weeks for a reasonably or even a large sized website.
Huge, enormous, big organization. I mean, I'm talking about the the top level. Just to give you the measures.
Yeah. Please continue.
Okay. Then last year, We had, I worked for this, you know, Italian, Italy-based, it's the Italian country organization of a large international network. They had to revamp their website. They didn't have money to invest in a proper research phase with their customers, customers, clients, stakeholders. Let's call them website users, okay? So we had to go through all the proxies we had inside the organization. And we identified two in particular. The people who were delivering the training to paying customers, those were the one, the closest proxy, the closest touch points with real people face to face, and the help desk, the technical help desk, okay, as another proxy of whatever people were looking for, what they were asking, where were what were the requests they were coming in on a regular basis, and that regularly people wouldn't find the answers for on the website, even though they were there. Okay, so we ran a lot of analysis inside the organization through the closest proxies to real users. And from there, we derived a number of problems that we then validated with traffic analysis to see if the navigation and the search patterns online were sort of, matching the picture that was emerging from the direct interaction with our customers. And all of this took 2 weeks mm-hmm. until we were able to formulate the user tasks, support them with the traffic analysis and with feedback analysis. So, and I tell you, these were 2 weeks out of a 4 weeks project just for this discovery phase, because the actual revamp, then it was managed in a completely different way and took them 2 months to implement. Does this give you a scale?
Yeah, I think indeed it does, Anto. Related to this, Marina asks, any ideas on how to pitch to donors for actually getting the appropriate funds for these phases, which are very often overlooked, not only by us, but probably also by donors. Donors would be willing to give money, for directly almost funding the development phase that what we put in the RFP. But how can we convince donors in getting funds, or maybe our managers, to get funds for these preparatory phases?
Get the data out. Support them with data. Data, use the traffic analysis. Get the data out of your traffic analysis related to the problems that you have identified, and formulate the user tasks that you want to get addressed. Mm-hmm. And you justify, in order to solve this problem, I need to spend as much time and possibly as much resources on a 2 week research and analysis phase.
Mm-hmm. Could you give us a practical example of where traffic statistics or analysis would pinpoint to a problem we're trying to solve in the, let's say, the user research phase?
Okay, let me see. How can I explain this? All right. So the way I did it last year, I started looking at the page views of the top 50 pages of the website. Okay. And it was a website with at least 1,000. They had pages in the range of 1,000. Okay, so we looked at the first 50 over a 1 year time span, just to find out that when we put together all the page views of the top 50, we were basically covering more than 60% of all the traffic of the website over a year. Okay, so 50 pages, pretty solid, sample of where people go on their website, 50 out of 1,000. Okay, then Looking at the pay at the top pages, I started browsing the website and see, and I started to look at, okay, where are these pages placed on the website? Are people coming in through this and moving elsewhere? I started looking at the so-called navigation paths. Do they enter from this page? Do they leave right away? Or if they start enter from this page, where do they go next? And by looking at the navigation paths across the website, I reconstructed, oh yeah, these people are trying to find out how a particular, in that case it was a logistical standard, how a particular logistical standard works. Of course, I couldn't tell from the traffic statistics whether the person looking for that information, you know, the person, the persona looking for that information was on the technical, the engineer type of guy or the marketing type of guy. I couldn't tell that. But that in, you know, what came out of from analyzing the navigation paths was, okay, there are some people who know exactly what they're looking for and they want to go and find the specifics on how to implement a specific standards. And we also have the people who need to find out, what is this for? I mean, what problem is it gonna help me solve? Then we took this data from the analysis, the page views and the navigation paths, and we just mapped them to the recurrent questions that were coming in through the training people and the help desk people. And we made a strategic decisions to prioritize the people with a marketing background over the ones with an engineering background. Mm-hmm. Does it make sense?
Yep. Which then reflects into your research phase, concentrating on, what was it, the marketing people?
Exactly.
Yeah. So that's somewhere how we can justify through the traffic pattern, saying, okay, well, this, we are serving a majority of our users this type or this profile, but it's clear that they cannot find the information, or it's difficult to find the information, and that's why we need to have further research on exactly what they want and how they want to find it.
Yes, that's one way of looking at it. But again, as with all types of research, you have to start with your research questions. Mm-hmm. Because that's what's going to give you a focus in looking at the data. So most likely you will have formulated the problems that your target users have from other sources, not from the traffic statistics.
I have one more question from Gaston. I'm not sure, you mentioned event subsites. So he or she asks, I'm not sure what Antonella means by event subsites.
Oh yeah, sorry. I mean, that was, you know, internal jargon. So the old CGIAR website had sections of the website that were dedicated to specific events, like the annual general meeting. This was this big, you know, annual gathering of all CGIAR people in one place once a year. Okay. So the information about these specific events were not included in the main navigation. They had dedicated subsites. Okay. With their own entry point or even their own URLs. Okay. So we just decided that this was definitely out of date information, so it wasn't worth importing it into the new website with the new look and feel, but that we would preserve them as an online archive with their own look and feel and put them under a frame. Mm-hmm. Okay, just because the information in there was definitely, you know, in the past.
Very good. Okay. And very often these event websites might have their own navigation and their own research, or might just be used as an archive post-event.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, okay. Very good. Anto, we're ready for part three. Ta-ra-ram,
design review. And we're running late, guys. Let's move on. Okay, let's move on to the design review. All right, here we try to bring to fruition all the hard work that we have done on, you know, defining the strategy, the plan, and the objectives, and all the cool stuff that we want to get out of the new site. Okay. Next, please, Charles. Okay, so we are in the big design step. Of course, I mean, here I'm not covering all the possible activities that you can have in that, in that phase. I will just, you know, focus on one, the design review. Our goal, tap please, is to get approval of the key visual identity and structural elements and to obtain actionable feedback that is aligned with our design objectives, the objectives that we have set up during the rationale and planning phase, okay? And to do this, two approaches that I've used is to organize a guided review with selected stakeholders, and increasingly nowadays, we use online prototypes. Next, please. All right, how to manage a design review. So first of all, what is a design review? Is the typical case is that you have the initial mockups or the initial wireframes of the new look and feel with some, you know, real content or, you know, the new branding, etc. And you have to show it to someone, most likely your supervisor or senior managers or the key stakeholders from which you want to get both official approval and sign off so that you can move on, or just qualified feedback that you can incorporate and, you know, engage with your stakeholders, build consensus, you know, the usual stuff that you do with your stakeholders. Now, because it can have such a strategic value, a design review could easily stir up a hornet's nest if it's not well planned and managed. And these are my tips on how to manage a design review. Ask specific questions that are in line with your design objectives when you show them the new design, which means never ask about aesthetics. Never ask generic questions like, oh, do you like the colors? Do you like the layout? What do you think of the logo? No way. Steer away from aesthetics and steer away from generic questions. Give your reviewers a very clear purpose, like, we are asking for your feedback before we present this to the board, for example. Again, this is like in a running research. You have to have your focus, and you have to focus on the rationale of structural and visual elements. You know, when you walk them through a design or you walk them through a mock-up of a homepage, you have to introduce each and every element with their rationale. We have this thing on top of the page because this is very important to support our mission to serve this particular type of stakeholder. And last but not least, don't obsess about the homepage only. I mean, everybody wants to see the homepage. Okay, but it's important that the design, you know, in the mockups or in wherever you show your review board, your review group, the design is applied to a number of page types so that you can show the variations. Next, please. The very basic way of doing this is to, you know, to just have, you know, show up a few high fidelity mockups, designs, static mockups of a few pages, selected among the most representative ones, including the homepage. This is yet another example from the CGIAR.org revamp. I ran the review online in 30 minutes in two or three slots with small groups of stakeholders. What I did was to guide the reviewers through the key criteria for the design mockups. Then I walked them through the structural and communication elements of the homepage and the other two pages that were relevant for them. And finally, I asked very specific questions.
In this specific case, we used high fidelity mockups because the new branding was an important factor of that revamp. So people were really curious to see how the branding was going to change, you know, the colors, the shapes of the graphics, how things would be laid out. Okay. In another and more recent project that I'm going to show you, the branding was not going to change. Huh? So the information architecture that was based on the user research and on the technology were the main drivers of the revamp. And in that case, we used an online prototype right from the very early stages of the design. And let's have a look at prototyping. Can you tap the next one, please, Charles? Next. All right. So in the previous example that I showed you, we used these high fidelity mockups. But more and more over the last couple of years, I've just, you know, observed that online rapid prototypes and online prototypes right from the start are being used during the design phase and way before the site gets into implementation. When you start with an online prototype, the main benefit is that you take a lot of the design and content conversations to the online product right from the start, okay? And in this way, the decisions on both the visual design and the content are more realistic, first of all, because you can see them in context. And sometimes, but that really depends on, you know, different factors, they could even, you know, sometimes happen faster, okay? And depending on the setup of the online prototype, the work on content development and software development can run in parallel. Let's have a look at how this can happen. This example is from the GFAR website revamp project. So the company started with an online prototype right from the wireframe stage, okay? And that's the, you know, what you see on the far left of the slide. It was hard-coded, but it was working in a browser, okay? So, and in the middle, you see the next phase. 2 months later, that's the version of the homepage on an instance of the content management system, with the initial theme fully working and with the first branding and design elements implemented. Okay, again, more conversation were going on this and more official sign off on specific aspects of the design. And then on the right, you see the GFAR homepage in its final version. It's the, you know, the version that is currently online. So one thing to consider is that, you know, with an online prototype right from the start, and in particular, if this is implemented on an instance of the content management system, this approach allows you to experience right from the start how the design, the content, and the interaction will work on all the devices that you're targeting with your site, including the mobile devices right from the start, and make decisions accordingly. If you have been involved in a website revamp over the last 3 or 4 years, you know that when you're testing a website or see how a design scales, you have to be able to resize your browser window to see how the content and the design elements will flow in the window when you move from, you know, full desktop screen size to tablet size to mobile phone size. And, you know, the sooner you go online with even a raw design, the faster you will be able to make decisions about where to place design and element and content elements. Next, please. Now, prototyping sounds very, very good, but it comes with a lot of, you know, pros and cons. First of all, you know, choosing what to put in a prototype could be a tough decision. So here, and plus, guys, I mean, prototyping is a whole universe of methods and tools and approaches and eventually strategy of what you want to, put in a prototype. These are just some of the rules of thumb in considering prototyping in the early, from the early stages of design. First, you know, the typical, you know, Pareto rule. I mean, you just, you know, choose to put in a prototype 20% of the functionality or of the page types that will be used 80% of the time or used across 80% of your website. You just go through, you just choose the most frequently used pages, okay, or the most frequently used content or functionality. Or alternatively, you may decide to prototype the tough stuff. For example, a completely new workflow or functionality that's typical, more of application development, really, not so much a website. But you may even decide that, you know, something is such blue sky that you really want to put in a prototype. And then you choose a fidelity level. That's the other, you know, big category of tough decisions when it comes to prototypes. You choose a fidelity level based on, in my experience, what you need the most, on a visual level, on the functional level, or on the content level. But again, you know, an example can help us better to understand what I mean. This is from, you know, the case I was telling about the Italian organization and its logistical standards. In that case, we had a completely new organization strategy, a new content strategy, and new information architecture, and a complete rebranding. So the decision was to prototype right from the start as a high fidelity static site with 25 page types, what I call core pages, with an implementation that were fully responsive right from the start with the real styles and the content samples. And to do that, basically what we delivered at the very end were the actual styles, the style sheet that could be moved on to the content management system, and 25 real samples of content that were used in the content strategy and for the content development training. And to do that, we used a tool that's called Pattern Lab. That's basically, again, it's a tool that helps you design static website, but gives you a lot of control on each and every element of the interface. Next, please. Do you have any questions or comments? And can I ask you just for a very quick break, guys? Just I need to get a glass of water, okay? While you, Peter, go through the questions.
Okay. Okay, go get a glass of water. All right, I have one question from on the a little bit more explicit explanation on the prototype and how the prototyping is moving away from pure mock-up tools and even paper design as we used to do 10 years ago to really going online, eventually already using the CMS system. That's one question I will have for Antonella. I think also I'd like to ask her opinion if this also needs to be integrated into the RFP, the request for proposal that you do with the development company. I think I hear you back, Anton.
Yes, I'm back.
Yeah. So probably one of the main takeaway points in here, at least for me, and picked up on this. So we're moving away from the old standard, maybe from 10 years ago, of doing paper mockups and doing Photoshop mockups, and using an online design wireframing prototyping tool, but not even a tool, but also using already the CMS and the style sheets, which later you can reuse to go into actual development of your website, correct?
Yes, yes, that's the point. Well, the thing is, guys, that, you know, here it's really a matter of deciding if what is the core stuff that you need to do with the revamp. Meaning, if the rebranding, you know, applying a new brand is one of the highlight, one of the main drive of your revamp, then going through a series of alternative proposals as high fidelity mock-ups done in Photoshop may be the way to go. In particular, if you need to get approval from senior managers that are sort of used to seeing something very, very polished. Okay? But if you are applying the same branding, or you're just applying a branding toolkit that has been given to you, okay, because your organization joins, you know, is merged with a new one, so you just have to rebrand according to a branding toolkit that has already been defined, you'd better focus on the content or on the layout, on the, you could move straight into the CMS because it's going to be perhaps easier to set up the styles that render the new branding. So it really depends on where most of the work will have to go before the final decisions on the design is made. So if you are dealing with highly visual, new highly visual elements, go for the static mockups. If you are focusing more on interaction, information architecture and usability, but the branding stays the same, it could be a good idea to start straight from the online prototype with the real styles.
Mm-hmm. And probably this is also something that needs to be specified in the RFP, because sure, not all web design or web development companies would have the tools or the experience of starting with online prototyping already based on the CMS to be used and on the style sheets to be used and the HTML framework to be used.
Exactly. Now, if we take it from the point of view of a vendor, of course, they will try to sell the best skills that they have. And you could find a company that has very skilled designers that are used to work straight into prototyping tools. Okay? Or you may, and they just would prefer to get sign off on the static prototypes. And then those get moved on to the next step to the developers that put it online.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, and of course they would have their own way of working also. So if you want to have something different, they will need to have the time and do the efforts of adapting, which will ultimately translate in the price also.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, and maybe a little bit later on, we can come back again to the importance of a good request for proposal that is sent out to development companies. Very good. we can have some of the examples from practice in there. But we're going on to the fourth phase, redirection.
Yes, the fourth phase, which is going to be very, very fast. And then we actually move to the final, you know, final remarks and pass the mic on to Mia, who has, something very interesting to share with us. Sorry. We have moved onto the big step of, you know, implementation and, you know, just the specific activity, distinctive activity I want to attract your attention to is redirection. Redirection is something that usually, you know, is taken care of at the server level. Don't ask me the specific. I just know that something called HT access is involved. And I guess that all the server administrations or people much more familiar with IT infrastructure than I am can shed more light than I can do. But the important thing is that in a revamp, in particular if audit and migration have been so important, because we wanted to preserve the content, because it's valuable, because it needs to be there, because it's part of the institutional memory, or it's just because, you know, the audit says that, oh yeah, good, this is all good content, we have to move it over to the new site, okay. You also want to make sure that you don't break the links and that people get redirected in the correct way, okay? This is what redirection is about. Now, it can be very simple and straightforward and done at the very last minute at the domain level, and that's it. Or, next, please. Do it the way, the very complex and sophisticated way we did it at the time we switched to the new CGIAR.org website, because we had something really in the range of thousands of URLs that needed to be redirected to very specific locations. The developer developed a plugin for WordPress. That's it. It just, you know, did it right from scratch, put it in the content management system. But the interesting thing is that we were able to reuse and rely on all the work that we had done during the audit. That is, we used the audit values that we had assigned to each and every page as instructions for the plugin, for the script here, that would just go through this table, identify where to go, and send people to the right destination on the website. Like in this case, we had created this very special action called frame for anything that we decided to archive online, and then we can see on the next screen. Like in this case, this is what happened and still happens, I guess, on the CGIAR website. If you find a link published perhaps 15 years ago, and then we decided it would be archived online with the same content, look and feel, that would just appear under a frame and a note saying that this is archived content that could be out of date or no longer accurate. So this is how basically we resolved the issue of online archival and preservation of institutional memory. Too fast, back. One more. All right. Great. So this.
Sorry, my finger got heavy.
Don't worry. But you know, we're almost at, you know, we're at the end basically. These are the the final remarks. With the redirection, we are now, you know, at the end of the review of the distinctive activities of a revamp. We've seen, you know, the factors that can drive the decision to go for a complete or an evolutionary revamp. And I'd just like to leave you with a final consideration of what I have learned from, you know, from this project and all this experience. One thing is that iterations and small ones are the key to manage all the interrelated work streams on content design and development. So whether you're going for a complete or an evolutionary revamp, the so-called, I don't know if you're familiar with the term waterfall. It's typical from software development methodology. It's a tad outdated lately, but this waterfall approach, like you have to finish one thing and then start the next one, does not work well with website revamps, okay? So you are running a lot of work in parallel in reality. So the logical sequence in the process that I showed you can help you see the logic, but in reality, you will be running small and short iteration across design and content and information and implementation and system definition. You may have heard of Agile. You know, the word agile is very hip and applied in all sorts of context. Now, going agile is maybe very hip, but it's also for a good reason, because it's not only about, you know, the software development methodology, but can be very useful as an approach to website management and enhancements over time. And it starts with you and me as communicators and content managers and designers being proactive in making the website evolve a bit at a time. We have to be disciplined in analyzing user data and holding those periodical reviews of what is working and not working and plan work accordingly. Now, this sounds easy. It's easier said than done. It sounds very good, but it's not, you know, that easy to implement, because in the type of organizations we work in, creating and maintaining an interdisciplinary team of people can be, you know, a hard task. It takes a big change in mentality. It takes a big change in the skills that we want to have represented in our teams, and eventually also in how the money is allocated to online and digital projects. Okay. But you know, eventually, this is really, you know, one word of hope I want to leave you with, and because perhaps this is what can save us from repeatedly having to call in the experts and start things from scratch again and again. And perhaps, next slide, we could have the best of the two worlds of the complete website revamp and the evolutionary revamps in small increments. I want to think that an agile approach to keeping our websites fresh, performing, and useful is feasible and not only desirable. And I would like to leave you with this very scientific diagram that I've taken from A List Apart. It is one of my sources of inspiration and analysis and solid analysis. That this has been called the maintain, repair, and overhaul framework, which is basically a way to try and bring together both the big bang kind of revamp and the ongoing incremental improvements. So after we launch the website, we do in a regular maintenance that has to be driven by traffic and research data that we can use in the small incremental improvements. So user research, and in particular, you know, analysis of traffic patterns, it's something that can happen over time, a bit at a time, and on a regular basis, without having every time to, you know, plan for the big research phase with 20 interviews and 20 people. Then, if we assess, however, that a change needs more time and resources, like, for example, a new plugin that allows us to integrate, you know, whatever comes from the social media platforms. In that case, we could plan proactively for what we can call an interim enhancement project. So it's still a project, but it's a much smaller revamp that's very limited and well justified. But then we will never be able to exclude that some big change is going to come our way. And so when big changes are in sight, we then can plan for a complete revamp. So I think we can try and have the best of the two worlds together. And this brings my presentation to an end. We can either open the floor now for the final round of questions and comments, but I really would like to hear from Mia and her experience, because yes, I've given you examples from different projects, but she has, you know, a story that you could perhaps easily relate to. Over to you, Peter and Mia.
Yeah, Anto, indeed, before taking the final questions, I would give the microphone over to Mia from the CGIAR research program on waterland and ecosystems, and their recent experience on the revamp paints. Mia.
Hi. Yeah, actually, listening to this presentation gave me a little bit of PTSD, and I wish we had hired Anto at the beginning of our process to help us. But actually, so we had a recent revamp, and we probably harassed a lot of you over the course of deciding to do it, what you thought in our research phase, what you thought we needed to do in our revamp, and how our website was functioning. But the major takeaway after listening to Anto's presentation and after going through the process ourselves is that you really should be careful about what organization or what company you end up working with. So I was actually, and my boss will, you know, appreciate that I'm throwing him under the bus here. I was in favor of a evolutionary revamp. I thought that what had happened with us was that we needed to edit a lot of the content and kind of reframe the way that we were telling our story as an organization. But ultimately, we ended up going for a complete revamp in order to move more towards like a messaging revamp. And the way that we did this was to focus on storytelling. As an organization, how do we tell the story of CGIAR waterland and ecosystems better? And so we actually did a lot of the research process internally. We had a really great team at the time, Martina, Marianne, Ilsa, Abby, all of this, like, we had a massive team of people, and we did the card sorting, and we did qualitative research, and we did all of this stuff. And then the decision was made to go with this company because they were good at telling stories. And they made us kind of second guess a lot of the research that we had done. And maybe that was, I think the decision to go with the company that we went with was a little bit rushed. And so my first takeaway, I think, is like, don't rush that process. Don't rush the research. Don't rush the selection process. Don't rush any of the stuff that seems really complicated and isn't as flashy. But if you do that, then you really end up with something that becomes like much less manageable later on. Another thing that was a huge lesson for us was to trust our instinct. As soon as we went with this company, even though they had come highly recommended by somebody that we very, very much trusted, as soon as we switched over to them, we were like, oh, this feels wrong. They're telling us that the things that we know to be true about our audiences, about how we use the website, about how we want people to interact with our organization are not correct and are no longer like what you would expect a website to look like. And they also had a switch, instead of switching from one WordPress site to another WordPress site, we actually ended up switching like formats completely and going over to Drupal. And ultimately, I think we are pretty happy with Drupal, but it was a much more involved process. So the first point is to stick to your instincts and your own experience and your research and all the stuff that you put so much time doing. The second one is to kind of, at some point, if you have those instincts, then you need to really like stick with what you feel is correct. If we had at some point been like, look, we appreciate that you think Drupal's a better platform, but we want to stick with WordPress for these reasons, and they had fought us on it, then, you know, I guess maybe we would have known much earlier that we should have gotten out of that process. But yeah, and then this goes back to the earlier point about not rushing the selection process and not rushing the research. I think that my boss calls it "do your homework," but there was another web company that we were really excited about. But it turned out only did Drupal. And so we actually switched. We decided not to go with them initially, even though they had also come highly recommended. And so I think, like, as part of the research process, it's not only about thinking, you know, what is it that our organization wants to do, but like, what is it that the web company wants to, the design company wants to do, and how are our goals aligned in a way that makes it possible to revamp something as complicated as a research for development website. It's not just about messaging, it's not just about telling stories, it's not just about making sure that your branding is correct. It's also a lot about, like, you know, knowledge management and making sure that the people within the organization can use the resource that you create in a website. So I guess I'll stop there just because I could go on forever. But yeah.
Very good, Mia, thanks. And I think that brings up probably something that we mentioned before, is the relationship and the selection of the website development company. You mentioned several issues in there. The company was selected because they were specialized in storytelling, but then they had the experience only on one content management system, on Drupal. And because you selected the company, they also convinced you of moving off to a new content management system. And it's probably, you know, worth noting that most of the web development companies specialize on one or the other content management system. There would be one on Drupal. Another company would say, no, WordPress is the way to go because that's where all their experience is. The other one would say Joomla. The other one would say Typo3. Or the other one actually has a CMS which they have constructed themselves in the garage. So in this, and I pointed back to Antu on the importance of the selection process for the web development company. And probably it's also because many of us are content generators and might know some of the things of the technical issues, but might not be experts. And that dilemma, you have the content generators, the people who are the owners of the revamp process. And then on the other hand, you had the external suppliers who want to give you a certain technical solution. And probably it already starts to go wrong as of the RFP, the request for proposal, where very often what you request the company to do is so vague that it's almost impossible to give a scientific quotation, financial quotation of the work. Anto, you want to say something on this? And I think you're still muted.
Am I muted? No. Is that okay?
Right. Okay.
Oh, guys, I wish there was a recipe for that. Well, yes, the request for proposal and the procurement process. Okay, you know, most of the time it's the institutional setting you're operating in that will give you the rules for that. I mean, if you're working in an organization with a highly formal procurement process, well, and that's a given. You just have to follow it, okay? If you have the privilege or the freedom to go and hire someone, you know, a company without a formal procurement process, my advice is to talk with procurement people anyway. Not because they're going to have a mandate or they're going to give you some constraints necessarily, okay? Just, you know, put aside the, you know, the red tape involved in kind of this. They may not be involved in the actual process, but they may give you some ideas on what to look out for in terms of how they're going to cost the project, whether you're going to link the payments to the deliverables, whether the company is financially sound, and whether they can actually subscribe to the legal obligations. So, though, you know, that kind of conversation can give you a lot of insights on aspects that are not strictly related to the technical performance of the company. Then on the technical side, what you're going to put in the RFP to allow the company to quote in a responsible and sensible way is, it's good to give them as much information as you can.
I mean, the more accurate you are on what you expect, the better you will allow the company to quote. And this I'm also telling you because I've been and still am involved on the vendor side. And sometimes there are requests for proposals, there are technical statement of work that is are just very, very vague. And that's true. But I've, so first be as, give as many details as possible on your expectations and on your current setup. This is very important, in particular this issue of, you know, having a vendor take over or hijack a scope of work is, for me, first of all, is a project management issue. I mean, you don't allow your vendor to hijack the project. In particular, when you know that you already have a knowledge base or a knowledge basis in-house that you want to leverage on, and upgrading all the skills of your team is not part of your project. That's one of the considerations that you have to make for, you know, what it's going to take when I have to run this website. It's just not the flashy project, a product that I'm releasing. So taking stock of the internal capabilities is very important. And then you just have to manage your project. A few months ago, I was called as a technical external expert on the review panel of for a website revamp procurement process. They were, you know, this company, this organization was trying to hire an external company to do this complete overhaul of their website. It was a very formal, highly structured process that was complemented by much more unstructured conversations in among the panel. And I'm still seeing to see what the final results will be. Because what happened is that in spite of the formality of the process, the person who got the more say in the conversation was the senior manager in the highest grade in the panel. So I'm still keeping my fingers crossed for them, I'm telling you. Because this person, the senior managers, was very much impressed by the flashiness of the, by the flash and glam of the proposal that they received. So I guess that this person was trusting her instinct that the time had come in her organization to get all of her staff out of the comfort zone. So it might have been a decision to push the boundaries of the web development and communication team for reasons that were not related to the technical worth of the proposal. I'm still waiting to hear how it's going.
Yeah, and probably the flashy stuff also goes in the end when they would deliver a website where, again, many of us who would request or project managed a website revamp would be content people. So again, we might be delivered with a website which is all flashy and looks nice and seems to work when you click on the different links, et cetera, but once you look under the hood, actually it's spaghetti code. And very difficult to upgrade later on, or very difficult to support Anto. So the flashiness in the choice probably also goes further into actually delivering a website, where probably, I don't know how you think about it, but in my experience, it would be important that you, probably the most important decision in a website revamp is to get somebody in who understands both your businesses and your business process and what you're trying to do, but also on the other side understands the technology and can look under the hood and be your representative with the technical company to make sure that you get something delivered which is supportable and is not going to cost you an arm and a leg to upgrade half a year or a year later.
Yes, true. And in fact, while you were talking, Peter, I was thinking, okay, of... you know, three revamp projects I've been involved in that have been successful, in the sense that, you know, the product was exactly what was expected, that the process was very rich and we learned a lot and we survived and we're here to tell the story. I was both on the vendor and on the customer side, okay? And in every one of these cases, the technical lead person was on the client side. So it's very important, you know, there's a consideration. I mean, I'm not particularly, confident in talking about technology because that's not my, you know, my area of expertise. But trust me, guys, I mean, some decisions, some proposals that an external vendor may come up with must be validated by an internal person inside the organization that has enough technical leadership to say, this is something we can support. In particular, if the key decision makers, like you mentioned, Peter, are content and communications people. Mm-hmm. So you have to have someone from IT that has a bit of vision and can tell you whether, the baby you're bringing home can actually be supported and grown. Okay?
Yeah. And that probably also goes for one part that we often forget in website revamps is something that Simon brings up in the questions is in the last webinar when we talked about search engine optimization. You warn people when you revamp not to lose your old URLs, because then you really lose your search traffic, your zillions of that incoming links and that internal links. Simon asks if you could, in short, say again what actions that need to be taken to prevent that loss of the audience. In other words, to have the old URLs translated into the new URL so they don't become dead links.
As I mentioned, there was, in the part about redirection, it's very important to lay the foundations for that work so that at least the URLs of the key content, the ones that were getting more traffic, get a specific destinations in the new website. So there are some technical arrangements that can be done at the server level so that, you know, search engine indices will recognize that there is fresh content and that, you know, the server has been set up in a way that will redirect also the robots straight to the new destination so that the crawling will be correctly, successfully completed and the new content can be indexed.
Yeah, so it is...
Again, so the more specific you are, the more equipped you are with a redirection to specific destinations, the in better shape you are eventually.
Exactly, so it is technically deploy the tools and the procedures to make sure that the search engines discover your new content, but also that the old content doesn't end up as dead links and is properly translated to the URLs of the new content.
Exactly. So that's where the importance of inventory and audit is, because that's the preparation for migration and redirection eventually.
Yeah.
It's dreary work, but it pays off in the long run.
And also links into in your early stages where you said, I'll make an inventory. So it's not just the names of the pages, but it's actually all of the URLs that you have, the active URLs.
Exactly.
Yeah. Mia, you want to jump in at this point on some of the topics that we covered, maybe on vendor selection and the importance of the middle person?
Oh, yeah. So actually, just one thing was during our interview process for the vendors, there was one other vendor who actually in some way should have acted as the middle person, because they flagged this company that we were looking at and they were like, if they think that they can do what it is that you're asking, given all this information that you're giving them for that little money in that little time, then they're scamming you. And they were like, we're not trying to get this job because we know that your budget is not big enough for the job that you're asking. And like, they actually warned us earlier ahead of time that the amount of information that we were trying to get, or that we had given, and the quotes that we were getting from other people were not in line. So yeah, sometimes just, I guess, like, be aware of those little red flags as they come up. Mm-hmm.
And again, you need somebody that understands your RFP and what you're trying to do, but at the same time also know how this translates into the technical work to be done. And they say, well, for $10,000, there's no way they can do this.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, very good. To close off, Anto, I have a question for you. We were talking a lot about external companies and external development. Now, Alu said, but how if you actually use internal resources? So your revamp process is purely done in-house, but it involves staff, which is often distracted by other tasks, probably production tasks, and is pulled away from development. Any golden tips there?
Go in small iterations, you know, just go evolutionary.
Yeah.
Just, you know, bit at a time. I mean, the important thing is to be proactive and look ahead, okay? And make sure that, you know, anything that is needed as a change is well documented and justified. There's, you know, with internal resources, you can sort of, you know, manage these periodical reviews and take stock of what is needed and try to make an hypothesis of how much time or how much effort will take. So if you really are short on time, you know, devote some of that time in making sure that, you know what needs to be done, and whatever can be handled, you know, internally, you try and do it. And the rest, you'll put it in a big backlog that will perhaps one day inform a bid with senior manager to devote some funds. But at least maybe, I mean, if you're going to ask for money, you're going to know exactly what for. You need that money.
Yeah. So do it in smaller steps rather than asking the internal resources for a six-person one in one chunk.
Yeah. I mean, try to estimate and size the project at the best way that you can.
I'll ask a question that maybe I'll ask Mia first. Are there any common mistakes that are only realized towards the end of the revamp process, mistakes that should be or could have been avoided? Redirection or lack of redirection of URLs is one, of course. I think, Mia, you already mentioned, well, trust your own instincts. If you feel that the development company is trying to hijack some of your original ideas, any other thoughts of common mistakes you've seen so far?
So one of the lessons that we learned is about customization. One of the big problems that we had was once we realized that we no longer could go with this company for various reasons, and we switched to another one. It turned out that the company that we originally had customized a lot of fields, which made them basically migratable to a new developer. And so we then had to kind of like redo all of those sections. So like customization is one, and then I guess tied into that is documentation. So those two things I think are very, very important.
Yeah, documentation, I mean documentation of the website development, let's say on the technical side itself, right?
Yes, so making sure that like the things that are being made are not only documented, but like also comprehensible to the team who's going to end up working on the content generation.
Yeah, content generation, and maybe also the company that would do the technical support, because the company that would do the technical support might not need to be the company that also did the development.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Towards you, Antonella, some more of the common mistakes.
Well, at that point, before, you know, just before you're releasing, I mean, you're implementing and you're releasing. I mean, you just want to, you know, get it over with, and you don't think so much about what's going to happen next. So perhaps one thing definitely you don't want to discover at the very end is, you know, as Mia mentioned, that so much has been customized that you don't have the internal resources to maintain your system. Mm-hmm. So, you know, and I hope that it could happen at that stage, but, you know, the sooner the better is try to identify the kind of agreement for maintenance and operations you want to have with the company that has developed the system,
in case you've gone through customization. I mean, customization is not bad in itself. It's just about, you know, whether you can maintain it or not. And documentation and training. One more thing that I see often overlooked is that, you know, the company perhaps gives you, you know, some documentation on a scrap of paper, and that's it. And they're just, you know, one of the initial, you know, the items that gets cut off just to get a better price is the training. Mm-hmm. And you don't want that, because you can make documentation and, you know, fantastic documentation, but there's nothing like going through a training course.
And this would be for people who would support the website as well as for the content generators who will upload the content.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, in particular for the content generators, if there's, you know, a big, in a brand new content strategy that requires, for example, a completely new way of generating the content. For example, in that project that I did last year for that Italian organization, the content strategy was so important that we had to have the real content on the static prototype while at the same developed in parallel with the styles. I mean, there was no separation of content and presentation, because the content strategy was so important, because it had to go into the training workshops for all the staff that were going to provide new content for the website.
Indeed. And I think my last words for wisdom would be for many of us who are content generators to make sure that you integrate that famous middle person early on, somebody that understands your business, understands what you're trying to achieve with the revamp process, but at the same time also understands enough of the technicalities to make sure that, one, your request for proposal, your RFP, is actually understandable and actionable. Secondly, that can help you with the selection of the company and make sure that they don't sell you rotten fish. And then thirdly, also don't deliver you the rotten fish once the website is delivered, because there is customization and customization. You can customize within the rules of a certain content management system, but which is still upgradable, updatable in an easy way. But you can also customize and change some of the core of your content management system, which makes it very, very difficult to upgrade. And then you're actually starting in a street without end, where you're almost linked to the company who did your initial development. So that middle person is really crucial for me in the revamps. We're at the end of it. Antonella, thank you very much. Thank you, Charles.
Thank you. Thank you for having me, and thank you all for, you know, having the patience to listen to me for 2 hours. It's a privilege.
It was too short. We should have had it for 2 days, Antonella.
Oh my God, face to face, as we used to do it, Peter, as we used to do it.
Don't tell the secrets, Mia. Thank you very much for your input from WLE. And thank you also, Charles, for your behind-the-scenes technical control and following with the slides. Thanks very much to everybody to participate in the interactive part of the webinar. You'll get from us a link to the recording of the webinar, a copy of the presentation, and then also Anto will give some links to reference literature, specifically on the user research part.
Yeah, a couple of books, actually. Yep.
All right. Very good. Thank you very much. And I see you guys within about a month from now on the next webinar that we'll announce in the next couple of days. Thanks very much. And you'll hear from me in the next days with the links to the recording. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye.
Cheers. Cheers, everybody.